Are you having a good time?
I think the movie is a record of what turned out to be a very successful tour. So I think it's interesting to see it from that point of view. I think also it's Richard Lester's perspective of what's been going on over the last 20 years. So it has a kind of a message as well. I think it's interestingly intercut. So I think, as you suggested, it kind of has also another slight feeling of like an art film. So I think, you know, it works on a few levels. And I think basically it's a kind of enjoyable evening out, you know, and that's what you want when you go to a film.
And it seemed that the most important thing would be to try to attempt to shoot a kind of love story, which was Paul and his band, Paul the band and the audience, and how they performed for each other.
This band is a really good band. They can play. That doesn't half help. They're nice people, so that really helps too.
He's a very special person. He's a legend, isn't he? I mean, in his own lifetime. So he's a very clever musician. He's a very clever person. He's very famous. And he's still as enthusiastic now as he was, I guess, you know, when you started. He seems to be, anyway. Which is, that's probably the one thing that comes across to me, how enthusiastic he is just to play. So, what's special about him? You get to play brilliant songs. You get to see some really emotional times when people get taken back to wherever they were, you know, when they first listened to those songs. And seeing that happen and being part of that is wonderful, really.
Coming up with all of that music and listening to all that music when I was growing up, and going out and playing those songs. Some of them I've played before, way back. Going out and playing them for people and seeing people's reactions to them and seeing how much they mean to those people in the audience. Every night was kind of amazing.
She was a woman, but she was enough.
His enthusiasm, I think, comes through the most more than anything. And he does enjoy doing it. And he doesn't, he never throws, it's when he's playing, he never, he's always pretty much the same. You know, he just enjoys playing. I think he'd just do that all the time if he could.
Well, the way he's a thinking person, he's an artistic person. He's not just, ha ha, I'm up there, you know, ha, look at me. It's more, he is a very artistic person, and I think his art is what's made him live on.
There was very much the sense of watching people in the audience, remembering when they first heard a song. And they were all in a kind of reverie. And it was that emotion that I wanted to capture.
And I think it was all down to the audience. That's what Getting Back meant to me, was revisiting all those people out there, you know, and getting the thrill of seeing a couple necking in the middle of Let It Be, or all those cigarette lighters they hold up, you know, during songs they feel particularly strongly about, Long and Winding Road, Let It Be, and Hey Jude, those kind of things.
Hey Jude, don't let me down, well, you have found me.
Just so warm, the audiences were so warm and so receptive, that became the bottom line. I mean, I still don't enjoy leaping around from hotel to hotel, you know. None of us ever did, that's why the Beatles stopped touring, you know. It's a bit of a schlep, I believe the word is. But the audiences made it worthwhile, you know, to actually, you could see quite a few of them. Even in somewhere like Rio, you know, you could actually sort of see what it was doing to them. And it's magic, you know. If you see them enjoying themselves that much, then it's the reward.
Oh, I see people who are just like the whole time, or smiling the whole time, or teary-eyed. I see great emotions. I remember Fool on the Hill, just because the piano goes up, I just see all these people just looking up, just, and it's like they all know him. It's like everybody feels like, come on, Paul, look at me. You know me, you know. I've been your fan for a long time. No, it's amazing. But he definitely brings joy, so much joy to people. And I think he brings great memories of things that people have experienced through Beatles music and Paul's music.
Tell what he wants to do, and he never shows his feelings, but the fool on the hill sees the sun going down, and the eyes in his head see the world spinning round.
I hadn't worked with Richard Lester for a long time, but I always admired his work. I had a great time doing the two Beatle films originally, Hard Day's Night and Help.
It was as if the 25 years hadn't existed. We just started up and started to work. I think that he trusted that I was trying to do the best I could for him. I wanted the film to be as much as I could, an example of the emotions that I felt, and that was that I had a very good time when I first saw the concert being performed.
The song Good Day Sunshine, he followed some members of the audience home
And he would spot someone in the audience and say, you know, do you mind if we come and see you tomorrow? With the idea of seeing who it is who comes to our shows, who are our fans. So you'll see someone and you see she's a nurse. She comes to our show, she looks like anyone. You see her the next day and she's a nurse working in a sort of, on a hospital ward. You see a guy the next day, he's gonna have an ice hockey match, or another guy comes as a big black guy who's a bodybuilder. You see him working out at home, you know. So this is another idea to kind of just slightly take it away from the average concert film, just make something a little bit different.
At this moment, we're going to go back in time into the 60s.
I think the 60s was a very interesting time. Certainly was for me, because I was in the Beatles and the whole sort of beat boom that they called it. We never called it that, but the papers did. That was all happening. It was very exciting, and, you know, we were just young kids, excited to be in showbiz, rock and roll, excited to be off the leash. You know, we'd all just left home recently, kind of thing. It was only 3 or 4 years since we'd been living back home in Liverpool, kind of thing. So, a very exciting time for us. The fashions were very wild, so you felt, I mean, now I can hardly believe the 60s were. Because you look at today's fashions and they can't, people are wearing what they wore in the 50s. It's all very preppy. It's all very sort of, you know. It's just a different era now. So I think it was an exciting era when a lot of new ideas were brought to the fore. And personally, I think I'm finding a lot of them resurrected now in the 90s.
The long and winding road.
This film seems to have a definite political slant and a very strong anti-war feeling.
Yeah, well, that's Richard. You see, the thing is, if you get a mature person to direct your film instead of a 24-year-old guy, he's got a mature perspective. He's not looking at the fashions particularly, he's looking at what really happened while he was there, while he was alive. And what really happened is astounding, you know. I mean, not the least of it, just being stuff we haven't even got in the film, like the Gulf War. I mean, it's still happening, you know. And we've only got this one little planet. And in the 60s, everyone's going, you know, peace, man, peace. But it kind of looked stupid. So I think now it doesn't look as stupid. The word that was mentioned a lot was uncompromising, and I'm happy with that. Because, I mean, really, we don't want a teeny boppers film now. I mean, that's been done, you know. My favourite bit, probably, is during the song Rough Ride. It's quite a nice recording, and I think we're playing it quite well. And then Dick comes in with some jokes, which I think work quite well, you know. So I think that's a bit of fun.
Rough ride. Oh, oh, oh. Hey, rough ride. Rough ride.
when the little chicks are coming down to be made into chicken sandwiches, I think that's a poignant bit. Back in the US, back in the US, back
in the USSR. One of my favourite parts of the show was the encore doing the Abbey Road medley. So that's a nice part in the movie, I like that. But that's probably because I like that piece of music such a lot.
The Abbey Road medley, when we have the three guitars out front, was always incredibly silly every night. But to see that from out front is quite amusing.
I like all the aerial shots in Rio. Are there any aerial shots in Rio?
Okay, thank you.
I really like the aerial shots from the helicopter in Rio. They're great.
The gun and a bell was ringing in the village square with a rabbit's on the run. Man on the run, man on the run. On the gale of night, Sam, Sam, we're searching everyone for the man on the run. For the man.
For me, I like all that stuff. It's something I was part of. It's something I loved being part of. With help, we're just romping around Salisbury Plain and having a loon, you know, so that's what I see. Exactly what it was, you know, with lots of little explosions going off and us jumping through a minefield, you know, trying to avoid the tanks. So, I mean, it was just a bit of a romp, you know.
I just was mystified by the Beatles when I was young. You know, I thought they were inside the record at one point. I was listening to them so young, I thought that they actually sort of lived inside the record, laying down, because of every flat record.
Again, that's good memories. The Shea Stadium was... It was the first really big concert I think anyone did, ever. It was like 50,000 or over 50,000 at the time. And they didn't have the technology they have these days. So, I mean, we use Shea Stadium's loudspeakers. I mean, no, you'd never think of doing that these days. They're just these little ones on every column. It's just that... Sounds great, doesn't it? I mean, we couldn't hear it anyway. There's a lot of screaming going on. It was great, it was a great gig, it was the first of its kind, it was a big crazy one, there was great support. There was some good footage too of the sort of, that's in this film, you know, with a couple of the fans, you know, really looked great, and the policeman was really sort of teed off at it all. So I think there's some nice things. I'd put it more like a minstrel, you know. Minstrels from through time have always been the ones that come around and sort of say, King John got killed in the Crusades era. Oh dear, oh dearie me, oh woe. And then, I mean, they give you the news, they give you something to sing about, oh, you know, and the dumplings were boiling over. They give you the comedy, they give you the news. and the music, you know, that soothes your soul. And that's the traditional role for kind of people like that. And I must admit, going out on tour, particularly to somewhere like Rio, where we knew before we went that it was kind of quite a depressed city. We'd heard that, you know, watch out, people will sort of rip your watch off on the street. There's a lot of beggars, there's a lot of poverty. And now there's the kind of warning things like disease and cholera and stuff. So we knew we were going to somewhere that was going through a little bit of a heavy trip. And it was good to be able to bring a little joy. Because I thought, well, you know, we've got this big show, there's a lot of lights, and we sing and we dance and we do all stuff. And we're vaguely pleasant and we try and, you know, give you an evening you can remember and give you kind of a relief from all of those pressures.
One, two, three, four!
Excitement in the rock and roll show. And I mean, sexiness, I think. You know, rock and
roll's
very sexy.
Well, Laura, I mean, I'm glad you got round to that, because I wasn't going to mention it. But, yes, you know, there is this rampant sex object up on stage, you know. Rather like England's answer to Madonna in many ways, I suppose. Just lucky I didn't rip my shirt off. That's all I can say. I think the game would have been truly up if I had.
The whole 184,000.
Oh, that would have been it. 184,000 people on the stage. Storm the stage. He's got his shirt off. Let's go for it.
But rock and roll is sexy.
Rock and roll can be sexy. I've never thought of it as sexy at all. I mean, we used to see Elvis. Now, you know, I didn't look at Elvis and go, whoa, he's sexy. I went, God, he's a great guy, isn't he? Wow, look at him. Doesn't he look great? Look at his clothes. Oh, look at his hair. But I never thought it was sexy. I think hopefully girls did. But us fellas, you know, it's just, oh, look at this guitar player, wow, listen to that solo. It was one of the good things about the Beatles. We used to actually appeal to the fellas, and we used to like that. We'd go to shows. We used to get a little bit annoyed at the girls screaming. Leave it out, you know, we've come here to play. And we used to like the fellas who kind of, because the fellas would be looking at the chords you were doing. Like, oh, hey, I know that, A, ooh, bit of D there. And we used to like that. We used to think, oh, you know, they're admiring our craft. I like it. I think it's exciting, it's invigorating, it kind of reaches parts that other music doesn't reach. It can be very rebellious. I like the ideas that it can throw up sometimes. You know, it can really give you a complete new slant on something. You listen to someone's album, you know, listen to a Floyd album or something, and you sort of think, wow, I now think differently about the world. I find that exciting, more exciting than kind of looking at it. Dave Gilmour said, whoa, isn't he sexy?
When people leave the theater, What would you like them to have gotten out of seeing this film?
The ones that didn't go to the concert, I hope they get the joy of the music and the memories of the music, and I hope they get the feeling that they were there, which I think they will. The people, obviously, who went to the show will just have memories galore. So I just want them to be full of joy, really, and hopefully they'll come out and think a little bit about the world and maybe change it in a better way themselves.
Hello, this is Paul McCartney, and this is my newest video, Get Back. Hi, this is Paul McCartney, and I've got a new concert film, Get Back, and you'll hear all about it when we get back to this programme.
Get Back!
It's a movie.
It's a concert.
It's amazing.
Watch it!
Fantastic. Fan-bloody-tastic.
Can we get any giggling people out, please? Anybody?
She's gone.
It was good. That was obviously a good take.
I got back.
I got back.
I got back.
I got back.
I'm getting back.
I got back.
Why don't you
get back?
I'm getting back.
Get back a lot of years. Go on.
No, he's got back.
I 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 got back.
Why don't you get back and go see Get Back? Got it?
If not, get it. Wasn't I supposed to say that?
You waited your bloody long, didn't you?
Right, come on then. Here we go, 3, 2, 1. I start with that Get Back, right?
No, you don't do anything.
Bloody hell. What about, what's my line again? Love, I've tried. Oh.
Why don't you get back?
Why don't you get back?
Why don't you?
I got back.
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 Why don't you get back?
Hi, this is Paul McCartney. I've got a new concert for Finital. Deal. Namaste, middle. Hello, Ina. It's the whole of it. Good luck. Good luck. What? Okay, let's just try that again.
Charlie Callis.
3, 2, 1.
Hi, this is Paul McCartney, and I've got a new concert movie called Get Back. And we can get back to it when we get back to this programme.
It's amazing. Get back.